watching a movie?
I told her she was live on Facebook and she hopped off. She hopped off. That's all. He doesn't seem to mind it yet.
Welcome, everybody. It's good to see you all. Thank you for joining us. Those of us that are live on Zoom, it's great to see everybody. We had last week off due to Christmas. But as I texted some of you and put out there on Facebook, we figured that there's probably a lot of us that are just staying home for New Year's, taking it easy. So we thought, why not go live and share a quick word, have some fellowship, and just have a good time encouraging one another in the Lord. So I'm going to do something different. I'm going to ask my precious son, who is on camera with his rocket ship, I'm going to ask my son if he could lead us in a word of prayer today and just pray for all of us who are on the meeting. So Noah, would you like to lead us in prayer?
Would you like to lead us in prayer?
Yes.
Go for it, buddy.
Thank you, Jesus, for everybody. Thank you, Jesus, for everything.
You want to finish that prayer?
Finish the prayer.
Say in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Thank you, everybody. So we are going to share with you just some thoughts, some word, some vision here for the coming year, some things that are in my heart and my wife's heart that we feel like will hopefully be a blessing to you as well. Now, everything that I'm going to share tonight, we have made available to you on our website. You can just go there once again. The website is teachjesus.app, teachjesus.app. If you go to our website, you'll see here, I have it on my screen. You get a verse of the day, a link to some of our YouTube videos and et cetera. And if you go down here, there's a Bible section. You can read your Bible. And over here, we have our courses. And then I also have a section here in the courses called topics. And I have a topic here entitled 2021. So if what we say inspires you tonight and you want to go back and take a look at it, take a look at the scriptures that we talked about on this live stream, you can actually get there once again on our website. And you can navigate here, or you can type it in directly and just type in teachjesus.app/2021, and you'll find this section. So I'm going to keep this short tonight. It is New Year's Eve. I don't know if any of you are planning on staying up till midnight or not, but my goal is to go about a half hour, just a quick word of inspiration, and then I'll also give those that are on the Zoom a chance to share if the Lord has laid anything on their heart. But I want to start off with a story for you all that will be, I believe, relevant to what we've experienced this year in 2020. And I believe will also be relevant to what we're going to need to take with us going into the year 2021 coming ahead. So I'll tell you this story about a telephone company. In the 1970s, there was only one phone company in the United States. And that was the Bell Company, who was named after Alexander Graham Bell, the inventor of the telephone. And they had a what is known as a monopoly on the industry because they were the only telephone company in existence at the time. And the United States doesn't allow monopolies. So they had decided that they were going to split up the company and break up the monopoly. And this was going to result in major changes in the lives of many of the employees, including many people who are going to lose their jobs because of the change, just like when you have any company merger or company buyout, something like that, there sometimes results in jobs being lost. Also during that time in the 1970s, there was a group of researchers who were studying about how people respond to change. And because they were studying how people respond to change, they decided that they were going to follow several hundred employees who were members of the Bell Company because the idea is, you know, what better way to see how people are responding to change than by studying people who are about to lose their jobs or go through a major company breakup. It was the perfect, you know, study group. It was the perfect test group for them. So they decided to follow hundreds of employees from the Bell Company, both before and after the split, to see how they handled this major change. The study began 6 years prior to the split of the company, and it ended 6 years after the split of the company. And during that time, they tracked many different aspects of the employees' lives, including their physical, mental, and emotional health during the change, as well as their well-being, both in their professional lives and even privately in their families. They were really studying their life as a whole to see how it was impacted by change. And they followed these employees during many of their important life events, such as, you know, getting married, having a child, their child growing up and going off to college. Just through these major events in their life, they were tracking them just to see how they were dealing and how they were affected by the change that they were going through as a result of a major breakup on their job. So when the split happened, when the Bell Company split up into several smaller companies, I don't know what all those companies are. I know out here we had Pac Bell, Pacific Bell, which was the Pacific branch of that. That was one of the subsets. I think Pac Bell became something else and got bought out by somebody. It's been a long process since then. But when the split happened of the Bell Company, about half of the people in the study who were involved in it lost their jobs, about half of them. And what the study found was that approximately one third of the group that they studied thrived in the midst of the changes that were taking place, while about two thirds of the study group floundered. But here's what's interesting about it. This was true across the board for those that lost their jobs and for those that kept their jobs. It was true across the board. About one third thrived through the change and two thirds floundered and had a difficult time in the midst of the change. And it wasn't, you know, the result of their circumstances, whether they lost their jobs or not. It was the same statistics. One third thrived, two thirds floundered. There was also other factors that you would think make a difference in how people respond to change, but they found that they really did not make a difference in this case, such as IQ, you know, average IQ made no difference. One third floundered or one third thrived, two thirds floundered. Education level didn't make a difference. Who their boss was didn't make a difference. Who they were married to. They seemed to see the same results across all these statistical categories, and none of these had any effect on the outcome. But what the study did find was that there seemed to be a difference in mindset that separated those that prospered from those that floundered, a difference in mindset. And here's what it was. When faced with change, when faced with their world being turned upside down, when faced with the boat being rocked, so to speak, the one-third of that one-third group of those that prospered, they responded with a mindset of asking, what does this mean for my future? While the two-thirds that failed and floundered had a mindset of asking, how can I get back to the way things were? Do you understand the difference between those mindsets? Because it might seem subtle, but it's really big. The two-thirds that floundered and failed, and when we say floundered, we're not just talking about like, oh, they had a mildly rough time. According to the study, there was many of them that just gave up on life. Some of them turned to become alcoholics. They went through divorces. They went through drug abuse, heart attacks, strokes. People that really just were broadsided by the change and couldn't handle it. Well, what was the difference? The study showed that those that were really broadsided by the change and did not adapt well, they spent the rest of their life trying to ask the question, how can I get back to the way things were? But the group that thrived, they were looking forward. They had the opposite mindset. Instead of worrying about how can I get my old life back? How can I get back to the way things were? They were asking a completely different question. They were asking, what does this mean for my future? So one has an eye back behind you trying to reclaim what was lost, but the other has an eye on the future going forward and embracing what is new. So my first question that I want to ask us all today going into 2021 is, are we sitting around waiting, asking ourselves, when is normal going to get back? I don't have to list for you the number of things that have changed our world and turned our world upside down in this past year. And of course, the phrase, the new normal, has been thrown around a lot, you know? But I think there is a large group of people that are kind of just trying to ride out the wave, if you know what I mean. And they're asking the question, well, when are we going to be able to get back to the way things were? But the other way we can approach it is we can walk with the Lord in the midst of this, and we can ask him the question, God, what does this mean for our future? What changes are being introduced to the world? How can we follow where you are leading us? Instead of being worried about trying to get our lives back, trying to get the new normal back, what is it that you are doing in our future that we can look forward to and embrace the change and roll with what your plan is? Because here's what I want you to understand about God. Our God is not reactive, okay? He doesn't wait, you know, he doesn't go and read the news first and then figure out, okay, what am I going to do now that I know that this happened? We as human beings are reactive. That's the realm that we live in because we're in the now, we're in the present. We get blindsided by stuff sometimes. Sometimes God will give us a heads up of things that are coming in our way. God just did that for my wife and I just a few weeks ago. He'll give us a heads up sometimes. Hey, something's coming, you know, and he'll give us a word that'll take us through that situation. But there's a lot of times where we don't know what the future has in store. So we're reactive. We react to things. We read things in the news. We hear this is going on and that's going on. And then we figure out, okay, now what are we going to do? But you need to understand that God doesn't do that. God doesn't wait to formulate his plans, but God has everything already planned out from the beginning of time. He knew what he was going to do right now before he created the earth. So when the world is being set in motion, when the big bang is happening and planets are exploding and stars are exploding into existence, you know, billions of years ago, God knew right then what he was going to do right now. Because God's infinite. There's no searching of his understanding. His wisdom goes beyond time. We'll look at this scripture right here in Acts chapter 15 and verse 8. Let me just go ahead and make that font size a little bit bigger for you, those of you that are watching on the screen. Look at this. Known unto God are, here's the word, all his works from the beginning of the world. Did you catch that? Known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. So that's saying exactly what we're talking about right here tonight. God knew exactly what he was doing and what his plan was. All his works were known from the beginning of the world. So what does that mean? That means that right now, what we're experiencing, COVID-19, all the turmoil, all the unrest that's in the world, God knew that these things were going to happen. It was part of the choice when he created the world and he decided to give man free will. But it's also something that he paid the price for when he went to Calvary. He knew that he was going to Calvary. He knew that mankind was going to sin. He knew that there was going to be troubles. He knew that there was going to be sorrows. And that's why it was part of his plan from the foundation of the world that he was going to come to the world, come into the earth, become a man, become flesh, become Jesus Christ. And he was going to pay the price for his creation, taking the responsibility of the weight of all the sins of the world, all the sorrows, all the griefs of the world, taking that responsibility as our creator upon his shoulders so that nobody could point the finger at him and condemn him and say, why did you create the world? Why did you do this? Why did you allow evil to come into the world? Well, when he created the world, he already planned from the beginning of time that he was going to pay the price for the sins of his children, for the sins of creation. He took that upon his shoulders at Calvary. It was his plan from the beginning of time. And as we go on further to time, now we're 2,000 years past Calvary, God still knows exactly what he is doing. Yes, things come that take us off guard. Yes, things come that challenge us. Sorrows, sicknesses, things that we have to deal with. But none of these things have caught our God by surprise. God has a plan. We need to get on God's page. So instead of trying to just look back behind us and say, oh no, when can we get back to the way things were? We have to realize God's exactly where God wants to be. God has a plan for the future. Even when there's, you know, bad things going on around us in the world, God is allowing it to happen because he is taking us somewhere. And he has somehow determined in his infinite wisdom that what is taking place in our midst is going to work out for the good of his people. That's in Romans. Where am I reading now? What is this? Romans chapter 8. I'm referencing a scripture off the top of my head that many of us know. Here it is, Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. I'll share this on my screen with you. We know that all things, including things in 2020, including things that are going to happen in 2021, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. So things work together for our good. Things that happened in 2020, things that are going to happen in 2021. But here's the key. It works together for good to who? To them that love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. So that phrase there, the called according to his purpose, is what we need to focus on. Because if we are not called according to his purpose and we are not following his purpose, then we cannot claim the rest of the scripture that says all things work together for our good, right? Does that make sense? So all things are not working together for everybody's good and everything's good, but specifically for the good of those who are called according to his purpose. So that's why we say, God, we want to get on your page. We're not just wanting to look back, trying to figure out how can we get back to the way things were. We want to figure out, what are you doing in the future? What is your purpose? Why have you allowed these events to happen? And where are you taking your people so that we can get on your wavelength, Jesus? My wife has a comment here in the chat. Here's what she says. She says she hears this quote. She can't remember where, but here's the quote. Without a point of crisis, it's difficult to change. Isn't that true? Can you relate to that? Without a point of crisis, it's difficult to change. Because when everything's going great, you don't want to change. You're like, hey, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But there might be something broken on the inside. We might be pursuing our own will rather than his will. But as long as our life is happy and as long as everything's going smooth, we'll just continue blissfully unaware that we're headed in the wrong direction. We're about to drive off a cliff. So God allows crises, I'm not sure what the plural is there, to be honest with you, to alert us, hey, it's time for a change. And that's why God allows things to happen. Elaine has a comment for us. Sometimes we are in darkness, she says, so his light that is in us can shine brighter to the world. Absolutely. And all these things work together for the good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. So yes, this is our first thought for tonight. And I have some other scriptures I won't get to for time's sake. I encourage you to read it. It's in my notes, teachjesus.app/2021. Find it. We have Jeremiah 29. I encourage you to read that scripture as well. Jeremiah 29, 10 through 14 lets us know that God has a plan. He has a future that he has planned for us for our good. Even though we go through bad things sometimes, God allows even the bad things to happen in our life because he knows that they are going to work for our good. So if we're going to leap into the future that God is calling us to, then here's what's on my heart. We must shed off some old things and embrace a new identity. We have to shed off old things and embrace a new identity. That's what I'm focusing on, leaving 2020, going into 2021. That's what we call a metamorphosis, a transformation. When we go through a metamorphosis, something old has to be shed, the old skin, the old nature, the things we were holding on to. We've got to let go of some things, and we've got to become a new creation, a new person, and come forward into the future with a new mindset. So I have for you here three things to shed off from 2020, three things to shed off from 2020. Number one, shed off waiting until things return to normal or expecting things to return to normal. Let go of that. If that's your hope for 2021, if you're sitting here thinking, man, I just hope that we get back to normal in 2021, let go of that, because I hope, you know, maybe we hope you're right, but I think that you might be disappointed if that's your expectation going into 2021. I hope that this is the year where everything gets back to normal. Bad news, friend, you might be disappointed. We don't know how long of a ride we're in. So let go of that. Let go of that expectation for 2021. That's one thing to shed off. Instead of that, we're going to look to the future and just ask the question, where is God taking us? And how is God using these circumstances for our good? That's the question we want to ask. Number two, to shed off, and this is a big one, and we're not going to cover all of this. This is an entire topic. In fact, my wife and I, we want to do an entire series on this in the coming year. But this is something I feel very strongly in my heart. And this is that we need to shed off offenses and hurts that were picked up during 2020. Now, this is going to get real for some of us, all right? And I don't know if this is what you want to hear or not, but this is what we need to hear. This is where my wife and I, God's been dealing with us. We have to let go of any offenses and any hurts that were picked up during the previous year. It was a tough year. We had things come out and challenge us that we've never seen before in our lives. People had strong opinions about everything. A coworker of mine was telling me how she was reading a Facebook rant the other day. My response was, I was like, well, you know, that's like 75% of it, of whatever, all there is on Facebook right now is rants, you know, because everybody's so worked up about things and everybody has their own opinions about, myself included, how we should handle things. Well, what's happened as a result of that? Well, many times there's offenses, there's hurts, because people don't think the way that we think. People don't respond the way that we respond. There's judgment I think you should do it this way, but you did it this way, etc. There's been lots of political commentary and debate and people's opinions on that. And what I have observed in my group is that, man, it seems like in some ways we're almost more divided than we've ever been before. So what do we need to do coming out of 2020, going into 2021? Here's what we need to do. I'm telling you, and I feel the unction of the Holy Spirit in my heart as I tell you this. We need to let go of offenses. Yes, people are not going to think like us. Yes, we're going to disagree, but that's fine. We can disagree, but we can put aside the offense. We can put aside the hurt. We can just choose to drop it. I don't have all the answers. You don't have all the answers. None of us are perfect. When we get to heaven, we'll rejoice over it together, because we'll see perfectly from God's perspective. But while we're here on earth, we're not always going to agree on everything. But we can recognize that we are human, we are flawed, and we can put aside hurts and offenses. So that's my advice to you today. Do some soul searching here as we end this year. Do some soul searching. Ask yourself, am I carrying an offense? Am I carrying a grudge? Have I hurt anybody, or have I been hurt by anybody in this past year? And let me bring that to the table of the Lord. Let me eat that fellowship of the bread of the Lord, of the bread of his presence. And as I eat that bread of the presence of the Lord, as I fellowship at his table, let me choose to let offenses go the way that Jesus let his offenses go. I'm going to do a whole series on this, Lord willing. As you can tell, I'm feeling this. I could spend almost the entire time here tonight just on this subject, but we'll move on. Number three, shed off clinging to our own will and our own desires. Consider that God has allowed the events of 2020 to be a wake-up call for us. And the wake-up call is, hey, we need change. We've been going 100 miles an hour just pursuing our own will, our own thoughts, our own dreams, our own desires. And God has allowed a major crisis to take place in our world for us to wake up and say, Jesus, we need to return to you. We do not have life all figured out. We are not in control like we thought we were. We don't have the master plan like we thought we did. We need Jesus to be our king. We need Jesus to be our savior. We need help. So God has allowed these situations for us to be a wake-up call. Many of you have been through, of our friends who are on, have been through medical conditions. And sometimes the medical conditions that we go through, sometimes those are our wake-up calls. Those are God's acts of grace that he allows us to go through a crisis to inspire us to make a change in our life. So thank God for it when we go through things. Thank God that he has mercy enough on us to be patient with us, to bring us to that place of repentance. So God has allowed these things to give us the opportunity to head into 2021 with a change of heart, with a new mindset. And that is a mindset of surrendering our wills and making our prayer, Father, not my will, but thine be done, which is the prayer that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane before he went to be crucified. Not my will, but thine be done. We talked about this a couple of weeks ago. Let the church make our prayer what the Lord prayed in the garden. Not our will, but yours be done. God is looking for a church, a group of people who will pray that prayer, surrendering our wills, recognizing that we are human, that we don't have the big picture, but asking God to allow his big picture, his kingdom, his righteousness, his peace, his joy to take over in our lives. So those are three things to let go of, to leave in 2020. Once again, let go of waiting for things to return to normal. You don't know when they're going to return to normal. I don't know when they're going to return to normal. And I hate to break it to you, but if 2020 was any indicator, even our top medical professionals don't know when it's going to return to normal. Thank God we have vaccines that are in the works. Thank God for our medical professionals who are working day and night tirelessly to help us through this crisis. God bless them. God touch them. Give them wisdom. But they don't even know when this is going to be over. So let go of that expectation. Let go of that. Let go of offenses, hurts picked up during 2020, even hurts of your own friends, your own family, your own coworkers. Let go of those things. Let go of clinging to your own will and your own desires. Now, I'm also going to give you three things, and I know I'm already at about a half hour. I'm going to give you three things to embrace in 2021. So you're going to let go of some old things, but you're going to embrace some new things. What are the three things that we are going to embrace? Number one, embrace the treasure of knowing Jesus for yourself in a personal way. I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about, you know, attending a church service, although if you attend a church group or you're part of a church community, that's great. That's wonderful. That's necessary. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about being a religious person. I'm talking about having a personal, ongoing, daily relationship with the Lord Jesus, a personal level, something that takes place in your own home, in your own heart, in your own life. That's what we're talking about. Embrace the treasure of knowing Jesus in a personal way. God wants to put a treasure in you. Whenever he takes things away, it's so that he can add something better to us. It's that he can add a better treasure to our lives. So when he takes things away from us in 2020, it's because he's saying, hey, look, I've got something better that I want to give to you. We're going to look at this scripture in Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 through 3. Here's what it says. The great Paul the Apostle, he wrote this letter to a group of believers that were very dear to his heart in the book of Colossians. My goal, he said, is that their hearts having been knit together in love, may be encouraged. How many of you could use some encouragement going into 2021? That's our goal here tonight, that their hearts may be encouraged and that they may have all the riches. Here's what we're talking about, the riches that assurance brings in their understanding of the knowledge. Here it is, the knowledge of the mystery of God. What is the mystery of God? Namely, Christ. Let me just break that down for you. The mystery of God is that God, our Father, who is invisible, who is a spirit, who transcends the universe and cannot be seen or touched or approached. He dwells in light that no man can approach. The infinite invisible God somehow became a man, became flesh. That's the mystery of God. The mystery of God is what? Namely, here it is, Christ, Christos, the Messiah, the anointed one. That is the mystery of God. And the apostle here is writing to us that his prayer is that we would be encouraged, that we would have all the riches that assurance brings in our understanding. And how do we get that encouragement? How do we get those riches? It's through the knowledge, the personal knowledge, the intimate knowledge of the mystery of God. And that is Christ, that he became a man, Jesus Christ, and revealed himself to us, made himself known to us, especially in what he did at Calvary, in giving his life and suffering and rising again from the grave. His entire ministry as a whole, yes, his entire teaching as a whole, culminating in what he did at Calvary and in rising again from the grave. And then there's that final verse that we have for this passage, in whom, who's the whom? It's Christ, it's Jesus Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. What are we talking about? We're talking about in 2021, embrace the treasure that comes from knowing Jesus in a personal and intimate way. That's where all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden, is in Christ, our Savior, God revealed to us in flesh. Embrace that treasure. We can't promise that things are going to get back to normal in 2021. We don't know what 2021 has, but if we embrace that treasure, we're not going to be disappointed. That's something that God has for us. Number two, and I'm coming quickly to a close, embrace the power of two or three. Embrace the power of two or three. What am I talking about? I'm talking about Matthew chapter 18 and verse 20. It says, "For where two or three are assembled in my name, I am there among them." That's all it takes. Just two or three assembled in the midst. God is there in the midst with us. Jesus spoke this. When we gather in his name, all it takes is two or three of us who are assembled, and he is there in the midst. Embrace the power of two or three. Even in the midst of our COVID situation, where it seems like we've been jarred out of our traditions, out of our routines, our church buildings have had to close and open and close. And that might continue on into 2021 as well. So whether we have them or whether we don't have them, thank God when we do have them. But even when we don't, we need to learn how to embrace the power of just two or three. That means that you can call somebody on the phone. You know, we're on the Zoom call. You know, Elaine, you can just call Irene up on the phone and say, "Hey, let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about this scripture that God laid on my heart." You can just call somebody up and begin talking about him. And the next thing you know it, his presence is there. You feel his spirit just like we're feeling right now. Embrace the power of two or three, because the power of two or three will get you through 2021. Whatever comes our way, if you can get together with somebody in your household, call somebody up on the phone, somebody that's part of your local church fellowship or whatever the case may be, you can connect and embrace the power that comes when we gather in the name of Jesus. So embrace the power of two or three. Number three, and this is my final point for the evening, is embrace the pureness of the Word of God. Embrace the pureness of the Word of God. What do I mean by that? Well, in 2020, one of the things that we saw was we saw a revelation of just how wicked our world can be. Many ugly things came to light. If you follow the news, there were politicians that were getting exposed for all kinds of things. There were celebrities that were coming to light that they had done this and that. And there was just all kinds of nonsense and ugliness that was coming to light, it seemed like, in the year 2020. And it was almost crazy. There's a few months there were everywhere. Every time I looked, there was something new coming up of things that were coming to light and being exposed. And it's not about taking a side of, oh, this group of people, you know, is bad, or this group of people made a mistake, or they're evil. This wickedness that we're talking about, it doesn't come from one side or one group or one segment of people more than any other. It comes simply from the evil imagination of every man and woman's heart that's in all of us. Unless we point the finger and judge anybody else and say, you're a wicked person or you're more wicked than anybody else, let's examine our own hearts first and see that none of us are perfect. We are all flawed. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that came to light in 2020. So what does that leave us with? What does that expose? Well, it just points out to us what we've already known, what we already knew in the first place, which is that the only pure source that we have to go to in 2021 is the Word of God. It is the only thing in this world that is pure. It is the only thing in this world that is untainted, unbiased. Come on, somebody. It is pure. It is without dissimulation. The Bible says that the Lord is no respecter of persons. He doesn't play favorites. He doesn't have favoritism. He is the same towards everybody. The word of the Lord is pure. I'll lead you to these last few scriptures as we get ready to wrap this up. Psalms 119, verse 140. Your word is absolutely pure, and your servant loves it. That's what it says in Psalms 119, 140. Once again, all of these scriptures, you can find them on our website in the section in courses and the topic 2021. Proverbs 35 through 6. Every word of God is purified. He is like a shield for those who take refuge in him. Do not add to his words, lest he reprove you and prove you to be a liar. God's word is perfect as it is. Don't add to his words and don't take away from his words. His word is pure. I just want to point out to you, what does that word pure mean? I'll tell you, if you're on the website on teachjesus.app, you can click any word in the Bible and you can find a list of all of definitions. Here's some dictionaries. And I want to point out to you this word pure. What it means is to be smelted, refined, or tested. So what it's talking about is like the actions that a goldsmith takes when he smelts, he refines. He subjects it to the purest and hottest fire so that all the impurities melt out of it. And what you're left with is just the purest gold. That's what the word of God is like. It's just the purest gold. You don't have to worry when you read the word of God that you're going to accidentally take in some impurities. You don't have to worry that the word of God is going to lead you in the wrong direction. It is as pure as the purest gold. That's the word of our God. So embrace the pureness of the word of God. Fall in love with it like never before. And that's something that you can take with you in to the coming year, 2021. So once again, to review those three things to embrace. Number one, embrace the treasure of knowing Jesus in a personal way. Make that your goal in 2021. Jesus, I want to hold on to that treasure. My routines are not the same. My normal has been shaken upside down, but I want to let go of my normal and embrace something new. I want to embrace the treasure of knowing you in a personal way. Let me make that my focus more so than ever before. Number two, embrace the power of two or three. Just get together with somebody you know and embrace the power of talking about Jesus, sharing scriptures with one another, the joy that comes with the fellowship with the family of God. Number three, embrace the pureness of the word of God. When the world proves itself, and it will continue to do this in 2021, it's going to prove itself to be more wicked than ever before. Things are going to come to light that's going to make you shake your head. I can't believe this person did this. I can't believe that so-and-so, this famous person, was fooling us the whole time, had this whole thing going on behind the scenes. There's going to be more of that in the coming years. That's the way the world is. Embrace the purity that comes from the Word of God. That's my word of encouragement for you. If you take those three things with you, let go of the three things that we are to shed off and embrace those three things that we are to put on. And if you do that, you're going to go into 2021 undergoing a metamorphosis, a change. You're going to shed off some old things. Yes, there's going to be craziness still on every side in the world that is around you, but you're going to be okay. You're going to be safe. You're going to be thriving. Even while the world is in turmoil, you are going to thrive because there is a personal transformation, a personal metamorphosis that has happened as you have let some things go in 2020 and you have embraced some new things in 2021. I hope this has blessed you. There are some notes, once again, on our website, teachjesus.app. For those of you that are tuning in late, I want to show you one more time. You go to our homepage, you go to this icon down here, which is the learning icon. Then we have our courses, but we also have topics, and we have a topic here called 2021. All the scriptures, all the words that we've said tonight are here on this topic. You can just navigate there. If you're navigating through 2021 and you want to remind yourself, what was it that we talked about in the beginning of the year? They'll be right here. Elaine, thank you for your encouraging words. Elaine says, thank you for the encouragement. This has really blessed me. It has confirmed some things for me. Praise God. Thank you, Elaine. Melody, thank you for your amen. Elaine, speaking of the word of God, a couple of weeks ago, Elaine texted my wife and I on a Saturday. She said she was praying for us and God just gave her one word and she gave it to us and she didn't even know it. But that word was right on the money. It was exactly what God had been dealing with us on. It was like, it was a triple confirmation. It was beautiful. And that's what we're talking about, Elaine, the power of two or three. You encouraged us so much with that word. You have no idea how much of a blessing that word was you sent to us. And we encourage one another. It's the power of two or three. When we gather together in his name, he's there in the midst of us. Is anybody on the Zoom chat? I'm done. I said I keep this short. I said I go about 30. We went about 40. Does anybody on the Zoom chat, if you feel like you've got a word, if you've got something that you'd like to share with us, feel free to hop in. Let us know if you have a comment. Let us know if you have something you'd like to share with us. We'd love to hear from you on the Zoom or if you're on Facebook Live as well. Let us know if you've got a word of encouragement for us. We'd love to hear if the Lord has laid anything on your heart going into this new year. Yes. Yes. Thank you. My friend Josh is on. Embrace the power of two or three. Yes, sir. Thank you, Josh. God bless you, sir. Anybody else got a word for us as we're engaging here tonight? Feel free to share it with us. We love you all. We know we got some powerhouses that are on with us. We know that God has laid some gifts, some anointing on each and every one of your hearts. And we're just thankful for your fellowship. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let's say a word of prayer together. How about that? We'll say a word of prayer together. So join in with us right there in your house, right there where you are. Join in together with us with a word of prayer. Father, we're thankful that you have a plan for our lives. You know the thoughts that you have for us. Like it says in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 10, you know the thoughts that you have for our life. You know the plans that you have planned for us, plans to prosper us, not to harm us. You have plans to give us a future that is filled with hope. It's in Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 11. Your word says, even though things happen into our life that seem bad, your plan is to give us a future filled with hope. I pray for each and every one of us that are on this call, that are watching on Facebook today. I pray in Jesus' name that you would help us to get on your page, not to look back to the past and try to figure out how to get back to normal, but to look to the future and ask ourselves, God, what is your purpose? What is your plan? What are you working in our life? Lord, let us look toward the future filled with hope, shedding off the old things and embracing the new thing that you have in store for us tonight. Amen. 2021 is here. Let's embrace it. Let's leap, like my friend, my good friend Josh has encouraged me. Let's leap into the future. Let's take the jump. Let's take the plunge. God is shifting things. God is shaking things. There is a new normal. There is a new era that we are stepping into. Let's be on the front of that curve, not on the reactive side of that curve. God bless you. Our friend Kevin says, awesome delivery of the word. Great sound advice. Thank you, Kevin. God bless you as well. Looking forward to the new year together with you, my brother. Amen. Anybody else? God bless you. Elaine says, God is good. Yes. God is good all the time. He can't not be good. It's who he is. It's his nature. Thank God for that. You and I, our nature is evil. We have to learn. We have to put on Christ, who is good. But his nature is good. It's his default. It's his characteristic. He can't help himself from being good. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Here's a comment from our friend Irene. She says, this is good. I could stop here for a minute, Irene. She says, if you want God to do the super, you've got to do the natural. Let's just think on that word for a minute tonight. If you want God to do the super, you've got to do the natural. God has some super in store for us, but we've got to do the natural. We've got to step out in faith. We've got to put some works into our faith. We can't just sit there and wait for God to bring everything back to normal. We've got to take a leap. We've got to take a step forward. And then the supernatural is going to find us while we're stepping, like Peter stepping out of the boat, right? The supernatural couldn't have found Peter while he was staying in the boat. But when he leaped out of the boat, when he stepped out of the boat, that's when the supernatural took over and his foot was walking on the water to go see Jesus and be with Jesus where he is. Amen. Great comments, great words of encouragement. Thank you, everybody, for sharing your word. Yes, absolutely. We're just going on in the chat. She says, we have to get out of our comfort zone. That's it right there. That's it, Irene. We have to get out of our comfort zone in order to have true faith in God's plan for us, right on the money. Get out of our comfort zone. So join us. Get out of our comfort zone together. Look forward to what God has. Ask God, God, what do you have in store for our future? I want to get a hold of your plan for my life. I want to get on your page. I want to get your wisdom, your insight, and then get out of your comfort zone and get a hold of God's plan. Start doing it. Don't just react to situations in your life. Say, God, what do you want me to do? And start doing it. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? It's a free for all tonight. Feel free to share whatever is on your heart. A lot of great encouragement going on. I'm sure 2021 is going to bring trials. We'd be naive to think otherwise. There's going to be trials. Of course there are. But if we stay with these things, focused on Jesus, letting him work on the inside, we're going to go through a metamorphosis. We're going to go through a transformation in 2021. Amen. God's got a new thing for us. Well, God bless you all. We've been on for a while. There's just a great spirit here. So I just want to invite you all to just join in for a moment of worship. If you're in a private place where you can, I know we've been on for a while, but I just feel like we'd be remiss if we didn't entertain the presence of the Lord. This is all about him tonight. It's not about us. It's about him. And his presence is here. I feel it. There's an expectation. There's just sort of a pregnant pause in the atmosphere. So I'm just going to join in and just give God some worship. And I invite you to do the same with me while you're there, right there in your house. Father, we give you praise. We give you thanks that you are an awesome God. You are in control and we surrender to you, Almighty God. We lift our hands to you as a sign of surrender to allow your spirit to come in our hearts and take over our words, take over our thoughts, take over our processes, take over our definition of normal and redefine who we are, redefine what we are called to do by your word, by your plan, by the identity and nature of who you are. Lord, replace us, transform us, renew us in our spirit tonight. Let there be a rebirth that takes place in our hearts as we shed off the old from 2020 and we look forward to the new of what's going to take place in 2021. Let us embrace that transformation as we set our eyes upon you and we are changed to become like you in your image. Jesus, we give you the praise. We give you the glory. I pray right now the peace of God that passes understanding to keep the hearts and minds of us in Christ Jesus who are on this call tonight and on this Facebook Live show tonight. I pray the peace of God to enter into our homes and into our hearts and the hope of our calling to be renewed and brought back to our minds of the high calling that we are called to in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. I pray for those who are sick. I pray for our friends who are nursing sick loved ones and who have friends and family members who are hurting. God, I pray for peace to be with them. I pray for strength. I pray for anointing. Hallelujah. To help us endure and to get through this season that we're going through today. But we know that we can do it with your peace, with your joy, with your help. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, everybody. I want to just unmute you all. And one more time, I want to just tell you all a happy new year. We love you. Thank you for joining happy us tonight. New year. There's my happy son. Year, he buddy. Says, happy new year. And I wanted to say on behalf of my wife and I, for those of you that are on Zoom, for those of you that are on Facebook, we're thankful that we get to do 2021 with you all. Even though we may be separated physically, our hearts, our spirits are together, and we're just thankful for this fellowship. So thank you for joining us on Zoom. Thank you for joining us on Facebook. Melody, Bobby, God bless.